distinguished leaders of the Malaysian palm oil industry, elder statesmen, and my friends from Indonesia, India, Pakistan, Malaysia, and all over the palm oil world. Before I do my presentation, which is mainly about price outlook, I want to make, as all speakers have done, a small contribution towards sustainability. And I would say, and I, as you know, until last year, every speech of mine had one slide on sustainability and the RSPO. And I would say that as a man who is completely committed with all my heart to sustainability, I would say one thing to my well-meaning friends from the NGOs. The greatest enemy of sustainability is poverty. So please be careful and do not push millions of people back into poverty. The palm oil industry has been the key to economic upliftment for millions of people in this part of the world, and will be for millions of people in Africa, in Central America. So let us hasten slowly and take people along with us, rather than create scare stories which could completely upset the economic benefits that this industry has showered onto us. As usual, I am very pleased once again to speak at POTS. I think POTS is a great, you can almost patent the logo and the acronym. I think it started under my dear friend Dato Tan Sri Yusuf Basiron. Is he here today? He was here yesterday, I met him. And of course, continued in the very fine traditions by the MPOC under Dr. Kalyana Sundaram, and I see that the chairman of the MPOC is also here. I think he must be interested in price. I think everybody is a bit worried about price. Now, at the Price Outlook Conference in this very hotel in March, I differed from all my distinguished speakers. I was rather bullish on price compared to all the others who were either moderate or bearish. And I happened to be wrong. And I think I owe you an explanation as to why I think I got the market wrong. 2017 was the year of record production of palm, soya, and sun oils. Production recovered in fantastic measure after the El Nino. It took 2 years to recover, but it did. At the same time, world food demand was also at a new high because the world was growing. I said that palm futures would trade between 2,500 and 2,700 ringgits. I was very popular immediately after that conference. I said olein would go to $720 FOB, and soya oil for Argentina would find support at around 750. That last bit of my projections came absolutely correct. And for a long time in Argentina, before the peso took a big tumble, soybean oil prices remained at that level, but everything else went southwards. What were the reasons? One of the reasons why demand has been slow or demand has been soft, and this is something that has not been discussed, but we in India, and I know there are many friends here from India, have found is that vegetable ghee or vanaspati, which is hydrogenated palm oil or hydrogenated vegetable oils, has been losing ground to milk fat. It was the other way around for two decades that milk fats, because of being expensive, were losing ground to vegetable fats. But in the last 1 year, remember, milk product prices have been crashing down. They've come down. And milk fat has been taking market share in a small way, but significant market share from vegetable fats. And in India, this trend has been exacerbated by this new yogi who has set up a company with all natural benefits, and pure cow ghee is something that the middle classes and the slightly more affluent people have taken in a big way. So we have lost market share to milk products, particularly in India and in other parts of Asia. 2017 was also a year of very high production, particularly in Malaysia. And the high cycle in Malaysia ran from March 17 to January 18. After January 18, production has been struggling. The trees have been resting as they usually do. Now, what are the latest developments in continuation of that trend? Yes, PME usage is today very economical, very attractive because of the POGO. And Indonesia has made aggressive moves to capitalize on that, and hats off to them. But I think, despite my friend Togor's optimism, and we are all well-wishers of Indonesia, well-wishers of biodiesel, I think in Indonesia, like in India, there is many a slip between the cup and the lip. So I think implementation will really take place and make a difference in 2019. 2018, we will still have to see how the higher mandates impact. And I think edible demand in the world has been affected and has affected prices already because of the very strong dollar. The dollar has played havoc with currencies of emerging markets, which are our main market. I am not going to speak about that very distinguished gentleman who wears a hat saying MAGA. I've spoken enough about him, and Dr. James Fry has done the needful. But the stronger dollar and higher import duties in India have created a problem on demand. The Indian import duties, I don't have to repeat to you how high duties went up, but this came about as a result of economic necessity. The government in India faced a problem of a huge backlash from rural India because of the fact that prices were too low, and farmers, instead of going up the economic ladder, were actually sinking down. So the government, out of necessity, had to raise import duties, and those import duties have transferred some wealth to rural India, but at the same time have removed demand or reduced the level of expansion of demand. And you will see that when I show you some projections on India. So, palm demand in India suffered because of high import duties. Indian crops were also underestimated. This is a common failing of me and most of my colleagues who report on India. Chinese demand for palm, remember, virtually disappeared because China started crushing soybeans in a big way for soybean meal. But the byproduct, soybean oil, started to shut out palm oil from the Chinese market. And palm's discount to soft oils narrowed last year. Even now, you must never calculate the price of palm today and the price of soybean oil today, because businessmen, traders, refiners do not take decisions based on today's price for tomorrow's consumption. You have to look at the price 3 months forward. And even today, if you look at the price of Jan, Feb, March Olein, for example, Jan, Feb, March Olein trades at what, about $600. But soybean oil for Argentina trades at $650. The spread is only $50. And if you go one quarter further ahead to April, May, June, then AMJ Olein is around $610, $615. But May, June, July, new crop soybean oil in Argentina is only $630. So your spread is still on the forwards too narrow for comfort, in my opinion. Do not look at the spread for October shipment, because nobody, soft oil people do not trade at such short scenarios. You have to take the spread 3 months to 6 months forward. And that is where I am afraid palm still is not as competitive as it is based on tomorrow's price. So, to summarize why I think I got the market wrong was that we underestimated the demand destruction caused by the import duty hike in India. We, in Indonesia and Malaysia, failed to step up biodiesel usage. The US was a huge disappointment. People like me were very optimistic about US soya biodiesel, but President Trump absolutely decimated the US biodiesel industry because he is a great fan of fossil fuels, particularly coal. And then, of course, there was the massive currency devaluation in Argentina. Argentinian currency, until a few months ago, I used to make a joke that the currency has fallen. You know, they had a big, around the year 2000, when the regime changed in Argentina, they had a big, massive devaluation, and they brought down, or rather they had a consolidation of their currency. So it was 1 peso to $1. By 2018, it was 20 pesos to the dollar. And I used to make a joke that this is the only country in the world which whose currency has gone down 20-fold in 20 years. But now the joke is even cruel, more cruel, because now the currency has gone down 30-fold in 18 years. Today it is 30 pesos to the US dollar. Brazilian currency also has been coming down. So these big devaluations have made soybean oil attractive. And this is something that Malaysia and Indonesian producers have missed out on. Palm stocks peaked at 2.76 million in Malaysia on 31st December. World stocks of palm oil were around 7 million at that time. I believe that stocks would come down during 2018. They have not come down. And the last quarter of 2018 looks heavy to me. I am preparing you for that, so in course of time I will reveal the figures. And the trade war has unfortunately also clouded the outlook. The friendly, on the friendly side of the market, production in Malaysia has not kept pace with our expectations. And today I have revised my estimate. My last estimate was 20.2 million tons. I have slashed it down to 19.2 to 19.5. Malaysia has not been able to produce, and I think this is a very sad commentary on the state of the Malaysian industry. Don't put the blame on rainfall. The blame is on a lack of replanting, a lack of a proper labor policy, and the lack of a general dynamism in your industry. I think it was very good that the new minister spent some time with us yesterday. I wish she was here today. I could have spoken to her brutally, frankly, about this. But many of you distinguished people who have access to the minister should point out that Malaysia needs to wake up. And I think a proper, with a new government, let me congratulate the people of Malaysia. Wonderful, smooth transition. No one would have expected it. I don't think even people in Malaysia expected such a wonderful, smooth transition. But having achieved that, capitalize on it and let your new government, with a very, very experienced prime minister, you have the distinction of having the world's oldest prime minister. It's a credit. It's a credit to palm oil that even at 95, the man is so active, he has lived all his life on palm oil. So, I think you need to get your labor strategy right, so that plantations don't have to suffer the indignity of being tight on labor. And if you do that and you have a proper replanting program, and nobody can implement a replanting program with the kind of decisiveness that Dr. Mahathir can. So let's do it and go forward. Otherwise, for Malaysia, it's a double whammy. You have low prices and you have low stock. low crop. If you see the results of some of the big Malaysian companies, you realize they are suffering from low prices and you are suffering from low crop. The Indonesians have at least the benefit of a high crop. So keep that in mind. I have raised my output estimate for Indonesia to 38.5 million. I noticed that Gapki's numbers are considerably ahead of me, but I still feel that I should be a bit more cautious on Indonesian production numbers. So Indonesian raising their production more than makes up for the shortfall in Malaysia. And Indonesia has successfully captured a larger share of palm exports. Year end, what are stocks going to be? I think stocks in Indonesia are already close to 5 million tons. And I congratulate Gapki now on coming out with very good figures of monthly exports, monthly production, monthly stocks. Malaysian stocks are currently around 2.2 million tons, but I'm afraid they will rise sharply in Q4 as the Malaysian production cycle rises later than the Indonesian cycle. I think the Malaysian cycle is looking at rising from October, November. So, I feel, and I know some people will want to shoot me after this, but I think Malaysian stocks are going to go up to 3 million tons. And if you are not aggressive on your sales, you may even go up to 3.3 million tons. I have never in my working life seen such poor exports from Malaysia as in the last 3 months. Okay, August I can understand. Everyone is holding back because they want the duty to go to nil in September. But what happened to June and July? Indonesia cleaned out on export demand. So this is something that Malaysia needs to watch. And for that reason, I am saying it will depend on how quickly palm prices are allowed to drop. Right now, palm prices are in no man's land. And I explained that to you earlier. When you look at soybean oil, palm is not super competitive. It must be super competitive. Otherwise, you have a problem on demand. Now, quickly going through other vegetable oils, sun oil is going to lose market share. It's a no-brainer. Sun oil has become too expensive. It's a premium oil. It captured market share mainly in India because it was the same price as soybean oil. Now it's gone to a premium. It's going to lose market share. Rapeseed oil, again, it's a relatively small oil, and I think, first, the lack of the crop in Europe, and secondly, the Chinese demand for rapeseed, because they want more seed to crush, has pushed rapeseed oil prices higher. Now, what is going to happen in this trade dispute between China and the United States? I have said on several occasions that the United States legislators have no idea of the sense of national pride and determination that is in China. And for that reason, I don't think this is going to be an easy trade war for the US to win. I think China has got enough resilience, enough determination, and enough courage to meet this challenge head on. Will this trade dispute linger in 2019? Or will it get resolved just before the midterm elections in November 2018? There is a silver lining in that for Malaysia and for Indonesia. If this trade war continues and China has to make do with lower amount of soya beans, they will try and import soybean meal, they will try and import sunseed, rapeseed, they will do all these things, but still, the volume of soybeans that China needs, as Thomas Mielke and others have said, China may have no alternative but to import 15 million to 18 million tons of soybeans. But if they try to make do without that, if they crush fewer beans, there will be less soybean oil in China, and that could open up an opportunity for palm oil. That is a silver lining, and we will have to study that very carefully. But it is likely to happen 3 months later, not immediately. This current soybean crop in the United States is the biggest on history. Yields are completely off the charts. The USDA projects a massive carryover because of the trade war. But everything in soybeans is to some extent a bit uncertain because of the trade war. And I, as an analyst, would not want to project prices on soybean oil because of the fact that we are in the midst of a political situation. Soya biodiesel was a big disappointment. Something could happen if the Republicans lose the midterm elections in November and the Democrats take the House. Because then the Democrats in the House may be able to put pressure to bring back soya biodiesel in the United States, which has been hurt by these waivers and exemptions which the Trump administration has been giving mainly to its friends. Brazil, I think now there is competition between Brazil and Indonesia on which is the more biodiesel friendly country. I always used to say Brazil is in a class of its own and a model for others to follow. But Indonesia is doing pretty well. And I think if they carry on with these mandates, then I would say we will be hard pressed as to which is the more biodiesel friendly country in the world. There's a big question mark on currencies. As I told you, Brazil elects a new president in November, in October. Already the Brazilian real is crashed. It's below 4 real to the dollar. Argentina is 30 pesos to the dollar. The Indian rupee, one of the reasons why demand in India is less today than it was. The rupee was 64 to the US dollar in January. Today it is 71. It could slip further. As the rupee declines, it is bearish for imports. You have a advantage if your rupiah and the ringgit go down. It helps local smallholders. Now, this is something that I want you to look at very closely. Not just the fact that I am projecting for 17-18, the current year, which will finish in October, that India will import 700,000 tons less oil than the previous year. As I told you, we underestimated Indian crops, and in the rise in consumption in India was much slower because of the weak rupee and generally tight conditions. But look what is happening to palm. And if you are from the palm oil industry, you should put this chart into your mind. Your market share when India was importing 10 million tons was 8.2 million tons in 12-13. 6 years later, India is importing 50% more. But your market share is the same, 8.9 million tons. Soya oil has gone from 1 million to 3 million. Sun oil has gone from under 1 million to 2.5 million. I rest my case. Those who think that palm oil is very competitive and India must buy palm oil, look at this chart. Don't blame me for saying it. I am only the messenger. And this is because of wrong, faulty policies followed by your governments. You want to export olein and refined products and put the Indian refiners out of business. But the Indian refiners are a tenacious lot. As I always say, refiners are the gatekeepers to the Indian market. Either you go and punch the refiner, or you give him something and he will open the gate. Giving him something means giving him CPO. Punching him in the nose is saying, no, take my RBD olein. This is, I rest my argument, but this chart must tell you, don't put pressure on your government to give you incentives only to export RBD olein. Export CPO. Malaysia from next month will be free to export as much CPO as you like, and that is a step in the right direction. Indonesia, please take note. Okay, a few comments on India. Our monsoon, by the grace of God, has been quite good. Indian government has a deliberate policy to help farmers. Why? Because next year there are elections. Indian economy is doing well, but the growth in consumption, has slowed down because of the weak rupee and the higher prices in rupee terms. Finally, one important fact which you must take into account. Indian agriculture is finally showing signs of life. Not only are yields improving, because now the seed industry has been opened up by the Indian government. Private sector companies have come in. So the quality of seed that Indian farmers are using is better. And year after year of investment in irrigation has now finally begun to show results. So Indian yields are slowly improving. All Indian crops are going to be better this year than they were last year. And also because of that, many of us, people like me and my friends in India, have underestimated Indian crops. So this is why I think Indian growth in India's imports is going to be tempered and relatively less than in the past. Will India reduce import duties? No. Because there are elections next year and Indian farmers are still very poor. Young people in India don't want to go into farming. They will become waiters and manual laborers in cities, but they will not go and work on their father's farm. So this is the tragedy of Indian agriculture, and which is why I feel that Indian import duties will only come down if prices rise too much or after the current crop has been developed and marketed. Otherwise, I expect Indian duties to remain high. Now, overall, to sum up, world energy demand is rising by at least 3 million tons every year, thanks to Brazil and Indonesia. World food demand is also rising by 3 million tons a year. Last year, maybe it grew by a little less, mainly because the Indian growth tempered. So here is my way of calculating price outlook. Incremental supply and demand. 17-18, supply rises by 6.5 million tons, demand rises by 5.5 million tons. But next year, 18-19, and this is November 18 to October 19, supply rises by only 5.5 million tons, demand rises by 6 million. But this mismatch is going to happen in the second half, not in the first half of next year. And there is still uncertainty. Soya oil expansion, there is a question mark, because if China crushes less beans because of the trade war, you will have less soya oil. On the other hand, we have to see how other weather-related factors shape up. And of course, I have projected that palm oil production next year will rise by about 3 million tons all over. We have to see how much that comes up. So there's a lot of guesswork involved in these figures. But by and large, 18-19 says that a price recovery is likely in the second half of 18-19, not yet in the first half. Now, my assumptions for price outlook, I think Brent crude will be between $70 and $85 a barrel. After I wrote this paper, I read that the idea of an IPO by Aramco has now been indefinitely postponed. I don't think any of us thought it would seriously happen. But anyway, it has now been indefinitely postponed. So now there is less incentive for the Saudis to support the oil price in order to have a success of the IPO. So let us see what happens. I think the Fed will raise rates by at least twice, September and December. Though again, if Mr. Trump's party loses the November elections, he may put a lot of pressure on the Fed not to raise interest rates. So we have to be careful. I think November 2018 will be a watershed, not merely because the United States has a midterm election. I think trade disruption will affect all our markets, and world GDP growth is not going to be as fast as people imagine. My friend Nagraj Medha gave a brilliant presentation today where he analyzed the growth of the United States. And I noticed, and correct me Nagaraj if I'm wrong, but you projected an annual growth of the United States for 2018 of 2.6%. The first quarter was 2.2 or 2.1. It was revised downwards from 2.5. Under the Trump administration, all preliminary estimates are very high. And when the real estimates come out 3 months later, they are revised downwards all the time. So the preliminary estimate for the second quarter was growth of 4.1%. I remember Steve Mnuchin at one stage even mentioning an expectation of 5% growth. He was asked, sir, who is the person giving the 5% growth? He said, I am giving the growth. Okay. Finally, 4.1%. Don't be surprised if 1 month later the growth comes out below 4% when the actual figures come out. So if the US is not going to grow that fast, and according to Nagaraj's analysis, the third and fourth quarter will be significantly less. So I am not confident that the world economy is going to grow as fast as the IMF has been predicting. So weak or strong ringgit will be a key. At current ringgit levels, BMT futures need to go down to 2100. You see, I am not very bearish. We are very close to a bottom, but I think 2100 is required, because I feel if RBD Olin, Jan, Feb, March, trades around 550, 560, 570 FOB, palm demand will pick up very strongly, particularly in India, Pakistan, Bangladesh, North Africa. These are the price markets. Now, if gasoline or diesel prices rise, then PME blending will become very attractive and discretionary, and as a result, prices can rise and not go down to 2100. So I am putting that caveat. But for really quick demand to come, for palm to go like hot cakes, like the cakes available at the Wilmar counter outside, you need prices to go down. I know that smallholders are under pressure, and I give a suggestion. I always like to lecture, and you know that. In India, the government has started a very wonderful scheme, which again they have borrowed from other countries, of called direct benefit transfer. So the government decides the difference between what is the minimum price the farmer needs and the price in the market, and they transfer that benefit directly into his bank account. They don't try to support the prices in the market. The US is going to do the same thing for soybean farmers, if you have been reading the press in the last few days. So I would say that governments of Malaysia and Indonesia, because you don't have too many, you have lots of smallholders, but these are all people with bank accounts. It should be possible for you to try this system of direct subsidy payment, or what is called direct benefit transfer. I tell you, the fact that you are putting purchasing power into the rural areas will do enormous benefit to the economy in general. And this is a suggestion. It's not actually part of price outlook. On lauric oils, I think coconut oil supply, everyone knows, is much better this year than last year. Coconut oil is very popular. Hats off to coconut oil. CPKO production is also higher, and non-edible demand is not growing at a very fast pace. Petrochemicals are still competitive, and I think lauric oil prices need to fall in order to stop stocks from building up. Finally, in conclusion, the Trump trade war has led to huge uncertainty. This is bad for commodities and bad for world growth. We have an emerging El Nino, and it is possible that when the El Nino sets in, when haze develops, it is generally good for prices. Suddenly traders become bullish. Generally what they do is they buy the immediate positions and lose money, because the actual effect of the El Nino comes after 9 months or 15 months. But ultimately it could be weather which saves the market and brings prosperity once again. So pray to God for whatever you feel like. By all means, I can only wish you good luck and God bless.